As the time for drunken horses opens, we are more lost than we're accustomed to being as the audience of a film. We hear an interviewer talking to a young girl who's telling him about her brother who has profound health issues, her passed away mother, her older sister who now acts as a mother, and the job that she has of wrapping goods at the market. When the first visuals of the movie arrive, we see a very close shot on the hands of a young child, indeed wrapping what seem to be jars in old newspapers. We pause for a moment, but we never see the child in whole. And then another pair of hands, and then a little further away, another set of children. And gradually we realize that the camera is placed far away from these children because we can see people moving in front of them and behind them, out of focus. But we are never allowed to see the context where these children are working. The one thing that feels stable in this opening sequence is that the sound remains constant. The heavy hum and buzz of a marketplace with people shopping and moving and talking and going and haggling and buying and selling. Finally, we pause for a moment on a boy for longer than we've paused before, and later we'll find out indeed that this is Ayub, one of the main characters of the film. A moment later, we see his sister for the first time, not knowing that she was the young girl who narrated the opening lines to us. And it's only another moment before we see their little brother, the profoundly handicapped Mahdi. He's dwarfed by the size of the bazaar, and we see him first in isolation, away from his sister, who quickly hurries to him and cares for him. Ayub, on the other hand, has to jump away from a customer in order to get another chance to make some quick money, and so he beckons his sister to come across to him and take over for him. This is the first moment in the film where we've had any context for where things were located spatially. Everything seemed to exist in a space that was disconnected, fragmented, and as a result, watching these children with all this noise going on and knowing that they're trying desperately to eke out a living, we feel a sense of subtle danger. The camera continues to be placed on a nice tripod and at a distance, so that as all the children, including Ayub, run for the truck that's going to give them some extra money, the contrast of the camera that's stable and the children running from far away toward the camera again heightens our sense of disequilibrium as the audience. In the next shot, Bowen Ghobadi fills the screen with children beckoning to please, please choose me, let me be the one. The man only needs 7 though. And then when he leads them toward the mountain in the wilderness, we have no idea what's going to happen. We don't have to wonder very long though, because quickly he loads great burdens on their back. We've already seen some children being forced to carry great burdens on their back. All of these images are reminders for us of what will happen later in the film when burdened beasts can barely accomplish their tasks. But these boys are quickly trying to get smugglers' goods into the marketplace before they're seen by authority figures. We feel the frustration and the suspense of whether or not they will be safe. And then the suspense is even heightened by the fact that their ride is leaving. And Amina, the sister, is trying to get Ayub to hurry so that he can be on the truck. We see Mahdi running alone by himself toward the truck. And finally, at the last moment, Ayub breaks away, runs toward the camera, and we cut to a truck that's taking them back to their village. The production of suspense and disequilibrium in this opening sequence helps the viewers become more connected to the subjectivity that we're invited to stay with throughout the film, the experience of these children.